let's start by me drawing your attention to Hosea chapter 6, verse 6. Hosea 6, 6. God declares, "For I desire mercy and not sacrifice, and the knowledge of God more than burnt offerings." We spent time on that verse last week. This is a recurring theme that moves throughout God's word. Again, be reminded, God has redeemed the nation of Israel. These people belong to him. He not only birthed this nation, he not only delivered them from their bondage in Egypt, but he brought them into the promised land. And when they came into the promised land, instead of following the Lord, they followed the nations around them and they got off into idolatry. And what was even more insidious is they not only worshiped their idols, but they also worshiped God. Over time, God brought certain chastising and affliction into their presence to try and correct them, to try and bring them back to himself. They were resistant, to say the least, to that correction that God brought. And so now God has Hosea, the prophet Hosea, on the scene in the nation of Israel, the 10 northern tribes of Israel. And Hosea is essentially telling them what is going to be going down to them as a nation. They're going to be conquered by the Assyrians. Why they are going to be conquered by the Assyrians because of their idolatry, and what God desires of them and how the heart of God is breaking for them. I wanted to share with you this. Now, this is Jesus speaking, and listen to what he says. I've referenced this a couple times in the last few weeks, just paraphrasing, and I wanted to read it to you specifically. Matthew 23, Jesus declares, "O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the one who kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to her. How often I wanted to gather your children together as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, but you weren't willing. And so see, your house is left to you desolate. For I say to you, you shall see me no more till you say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." We see the heart of our God for his people who belong to him broken over their sin and their rebellion toward him. And although as we make our way through Hosea, there is verse after verse of highlighting their sin and communicating the chastisement and the discipline that's going to come upon the nation, we also see a beautiful broken heart of God our Father, if you will, over the rebellion in the sin of his children. And how amazing there that in verse 6, he tells them, "I desire mercy and not sacrifice, and the knowledge of God more than burnt offerings." I don't want your religious ritual. I want your heart. I want your lives. I want you to be following me as my sons and my daughters. And of course, that is a theme that continues right on in through the church today. So we pick up our study in Hosea chapter 7, verse 1. Again, we're surveying the Bible on Sunday mornings, and so we'll be taking three chapters here this morning in less of an in-depth style and more of a survey. God is speaking in Hosea 7, continuing his conversation from chapter 6, and he says, "When I, the Lord, would have healed Israel, then the iniquity of Ephraim was uncovered and the wickedness of Samaria." Notice that God the Father says that he has a desire to heal. He has a desire to guide his people in righteousness. But unfortunately, the closer that he looked at his people, the more he uncovered, the more he discovered additional ongoing sin. Now he's God and he knows everything that's happening. But he's communicating to them the layers of their sin. There were the layers that were on the outside that everybody could see. There were the layers on the inside that nobody could see. He says, "They, Israel, they've committed fraud. A thief comes in, a band of robbers takes spoil outside." In other words, there was theft on the inside of the nation. There was theft on the outside of the nation. The enemy was destroying them from within. The enemy was destroying them from without. No, I'm not thinking of the United States of America either. Oh, maybe I am. Maybe we should. "They do not consider in their hearts that I, the Lord, remember all their wickedness." God's taking an accounting. God takes note. The sin that is unconfessed, the sin that is unrepented of, God takes an accounting of. Now their own deeds have surrounded them, and they are before my face, says the Lord. One scholar has said, secret sin on earth is open scandal in heaven. Secret sin on earth. Oh, nobody sees, nobody knows. This is just me. This is something that I'm doing. No one else knows. Is a scandal. An open scandal in heaven. Israel, verse 3, they make a king glad with their wickedness and princes with their lies. The wickedness in Israel, the nation of Israel, was so bad that the rulers encouraged the people to sin, and the people encouraged the rulers to sin. In fact, it was as if society found pleasure in ungodliness. Can we think of a time, can we think of a place, can we think of a nation where the people encourage the rulers to sin and the rulers encourage the people to sin? We're not Israel, but we're living right there. This nation, this world ripe for judgment. In verse 4, God says of Israel, they are all adulterers. The Hebrew is habitually, they are all habitually adulterers. Like an oven heated by a baker, he ceases stirring the fire after kneading the dough until it is leavened. The idea here is that the flames of Israel's sin, they're kept low. The embers of the flames are kept low until the baker is ready. Then he blows the embers into a flame. And when Israel sees the opportunity to sin, those embers of sin, they blast upwards. Do you ever get the sense that we live in a nation that there's just this undercurrent of sin? And when the time is right, it's Satan just blows on those embers and the flames come up and there's riots in the streets and corruption in the halls of our government. Verse 5, in the day of our king, this is a special day, a day that should be filled with honor and respect for the king. In the day of our king, princes have made the king sick, inflamed him with wine. He's drunk. He stretched out his hand with scoffers. The king and the people that are around him behave as fools because of their sin. They prepare their heart like an oven while they lie in wait. Their baker sleeps all night. In the morning, it burns like a flaming fire. That is to say, restraint, respectability, and righteousness are cast aside for the opportunity to indulge in wickedness. You know, I have to be careful hammering our own nation because we could hammer the nations of the world. This is where our culture and society as a world are going today. Yet I have to be careful as well because judgment begins in the house of God. The church today, the church at large, restraint, respectability, and righteousness cast aside for the opportunity to indulge in wickedness. To rob and steal and plunder the people of God, both monetarily, and physically, and spiritually. God says of Israel in verse 7, they are all hot like an oven and have devoured their judges or their kings. All their kings have fallen. In the nation of Israel, over a 20-year span, they had four kings that were assassinated in just 20 years. Can you imagine your chosen man, that the person that you believe is going to deliver you as a nation, is raised to the place of having the throne of the nation and then to be assassinated? And that happened four times in 20 years. Notice there the last phrase of verse 7. None among them calls upon me. The them there is referring to the kings. None of the kings of Israel, no one in Israel, God says, calls upon me. Maybe if you're a parent of a little bit older child, you can relate to this. You watch the life of your child. You maybe watch the life of a family member. I just had a I don't know how many funerals we're up to now in my family in the last 6 months. They're just, we're at that point. I'm one of the youngest ones in my family. And so aunts and uncles all ahead of me, they're starting to drop. And you watch, your heart breaks. I have the answers. I can point you to Jesus. I'm desirous to share with you. None of them calls upon me, says the Lord. The Lord God, he's the true King of Israel. He's the source of national stability for the nation of Israel. If the nation, if their kings had called upon the King of Israel, the Lord God Almighty, think of the stability that it could have come to that nation. What a joke when our nation, the United States of America, has a national day of prayer. One day. A national day. We're all going to pray on this day. What? Why isn't every day a national day of prayer for a nation that is built on the foundation of "In God We Trust"? God says none of them calls upon me. Ephraim, the nation of Israel, verse 8, has mixed himself among the peoples. In other words, they haven't stayed separate from the world. They look just like the world. Oh my goodness, our churches today, they look just like the world. They behave like the world. Israel, they've mixed themselves among the peoples. Ephraim is a cake unturned, a cake unturned. Think about not a cake like three layers birthday cake. Think of a cake like a pancake. God says of Israel, they're like a cake unturned. They're cooked on one side and they're raw on the other. On one side, they have the appearance of a nation, well, oh, very, very nice, beautiful, well, oh, that's very good. But they have the appearance from another perspective of being raw and not done. Aliens, verse 9, or Gentiles, have devoured Israel's strength. They're weak, but Israel doesn't know it. Yes, gray hairs are here and there on him, on Israel, yet he doesn't know it. Israel, verse 9 says to us, is weak and is strong, or is weak and is old, I'm sorry, is weak and old, and they don't recognize it. I wrote here next to verse 9, I wrote this, sin makes us senseless. When we're in sin, we're blind to the fact that we're getting weaker. When we're in sin, we're blind to the fact that we're getting older and decrepit, maybe not physically, but spiritually. Israel as a nation was becoming weak. They were becoming old and broken down in their sin and their wickedness. And they absolutely couldn't see it. Sin makes us senseless. And verse 10, and the pride of Israel testifies to his face. In other words, the effects of their sin are right in front of them. This is the individual that's lost his wife. He's lost his kids. He's lost his house. He's lost his car because of his sin of gambling. And yet the solution to his problem is if he could just hit the big one. The pride of Israel testifies to his face. Look at this. But they do not return to the Lord their God, nor seek him for all this. Here's what I wrote in my notes. You may do differently if you wish. But I wrote this. In capital letters, I wrote this. And that is the end of pride. Where does pride, where does lack of humility, where does stubbornness end up? I'm not returning to the Lord. I'm not going to seek him. I don't need him. I've got it all together. I'm just fine. I'm okay. You're okay. We're all okay together in this. In Israel, look at this. They do not return to the Lord their God. Do you see the power of that phrase? They do not return. They were with God. They did walk with God. And they refused to return. And beyond that, they don't even seek him. We know other texts in the Bible describe that God is seeking, he's looking for, he's desirous for those that are willing to seek him. If you seek me, God says, you'll find me. If you seek me with all your heart, I'm right there. I'm there for you. But man's pride and a nation's pride says, no. We got this. Everything's okay. And so God says of them, verse 11, Ephraim also is like a silly dove and without sense. They call to Egypt and they go to Assyria. Israel, instead of turning to God, they turn to their enemies. They turn to the Assyrians and the Egyptians. Hey, we want you to deliver us. Now, here's God, God who birthed them, God who delivered them, God who has provided for them. And they go, oh, no, we're not going to turn to God. We're going to turn to our enemies. This is the Christian whose life is falling apart. And instead of turning to his pastor, turning to his God for assistance, he goes to his boss. Oh, if I could just have a raise, everything would be okay. God says, wherever they go, I, the Lord, will spread my net on them. Continuing this picture of silly doves without sense. I, the Lord, will bring them down like birds of the air. I will chastise them. Look at this. According to what their congregation has heard. So there's two ideas here. One is that God is going to bring Israel down and hold her in the place of correction. Israel, like a dove, isn't going to be able to fly freely and senselessly any longer. God is going to capture her. God is going to bring her down, and he is going to restrain her. But notice even more, this is so instructional for us. God says, I will chastise them or punish them or correct them according to what their congregation has heard. This is very insightful for us when we think about God and how he handles those children of his that he loves. He never chastises them. He never corrects them based on ignorance, but always on the information that they had. Mom and Dad, have you ever had an opportunity to do this? Man, something goes down in the house with one of your kids and you just feel it welling up within you. The stupidity, that kid, this is it. I'm coming after him. And you hear the Holy Spirit of God say, wait a minute. You never talked to your child about that. You never gave them instruction in that area. That may be just totally obvious to you that that's something that they shouldn't do. But the fact of the matter is, that's not an area you've never instructed them in. That's never an area that you have trained them in. And you know what? You throttle back. You sit down with the child. And you know what? I'm sorry that you did that. But I'm also sorry that that's something that I never instructed you in. I never trained you regarding. So you know what? Forewarned is forearmed. Don't do it again. This is God. He chastises based on what we've heard, on what we know. All the responsibility that comes with going to a church that isn't a country club. The responsibility that comes with attending and being a part of a church that isn't a social center. The responsibility that comes with being part of a church that isn't an entertainment venue. And I know none of you are being entertained this morning. We're in Hosea. There's a responsibility. God says that you have very little ignorance. You're being expositionally taught the entire word of God from Genesis to Revelation. God says of Israel, woe to them, for they, Israel, have fled from me, the Lord. They've left me, verse 13. Destruction to them because they have transgressed against me. In other words, their disobedience to God brings their destruction. You ever seen somebody be destroyed? You ever seen a Christian be destroyed? It's heartbreaking. And yet you recognize that their destruction is coming about because of their disobedience to God. And you also realize that at the moment that they're willing to repent, God is willing to forgive and he's willing to restore, to lift them up, to raise them up, to form and mold and shape them into a vessel of honor, fit for the master's hand. God says, woe to them, they fled from me, destruction to them, because they have transgressed against me. Though I, the Lord, redeemed them, God was the one that brought them out of the slavery of Egypt, yet they have spoken lies against me. The people of Israel say, oh, God doesn't love us. And Christian, this is a testimony that is each of ours. For each of us that have been born again by the Spirit of God, we have been redeemed. We have been bought out of slavery by the cross of Calvary, by the Lord Jesus Christ. We have been saved. We have been set free. And yet, would there be any of us that when chastisement comes, when consequences come for us living in rebellion to the Lord, that we speak lies against God and go, I can't believe this. God doesn't love me. Oh, no. God loves you desperately and dearly, and that's why he's chastising you. That's why he's correcting you. See, here's the progression. God saves us at the cross. And then if we're not careful, if we don't walk in relationship and fellowship with him, we end up in the place of rebellion and we run from him. And then when we run from him, we say, oh, God doesn't love me. And the reality is, in charging God with wrongdoing, we lay rebellion upon rebellion upon rebellion. Because he who sacrificed his son for us, that is the ultimate manifestation of God's love for us. To ever charge God with wrongdoing, to speak lies against him, God forbid. In verse 14, takes the poignancy even a step further. God says of Israel, they did not cry out to me with their heart when they wailed upon their beds. Oh, they're wailing. They're crying. It's just not coming from their heart. It's not coming from the core of their being. It's not coming from that area that guides and directs a man or a woman. Oh, they're crying because they don't like the punishment. They don't like the consequences. They're wailing, not in repentance for their sin, but because of the sting of their punishment. When God comes and he touches a man or a woman because of the sin in their life, and they cry out, how can you handle me like this? How can you speak to me like this? How can you bring this up? That's not repentance. That's the pain of somebody who's been identified and revealed. This is instructive to us. Let us never find ourselves in that place where God speaks into our hearts and he speaks into our lives and we cry out. But our cries aren't cries of repentance. They're cries of, I can't believe I got busted. They assemble together for grain and new wine. They rebel against me. God says, the people, instead of repenting, they're gathering together to party. They'd rather party than repent. They'd rather rebel than repent. God says, though I, the Lord, disciplined and strengthened their arms, the usage of the word disciplined here is the speaking of the discipline that comes with a training, like for an athlete or an old man like myself that just wants to get in shape. It takes discipline. It's that kind of discipline. Though I disciplined and strengthened their arms, what did they use that strength for? To devise evil against me. God says, I trained them. I strengthened them, and they used what I gave them to devise evil against me. In fact, verse 16, they return or they repent, but not to the Most High. This is the husband that goes to his wife, oh, I'm so sorry. This is the wife that goes to her husband, oh, I'm so sorry. This is the parent that goes to their child. Oh, I'm so sorry. This is the individual that goes to their boss. Oh, I'm so sorry. But they never repent to God. See, it's an outward. Oh, look at them. They're so very sad. Look at the big crocodile tears. But it's all external. They return, they repent, but not to the Most High. They go and confess to everyone. They go and ask everybody's forgiveness, but not God's. And so God says of them, they're like a treacherous bow, a bow and arrow that doesn't shoot straight. Their princes or their leaders shall fall by the sword. For the cursings of their tongue, this shall be their derision or their ridicule in the land of Egypt. That is, when their enemies come upon them. And so in chapter 8, God says, set the trumpet to your mouth. Speaking of the Assyrians coming to war against Israel. He, Assyria, shall come like an eagle against the house of the Lord. Why? Well, here we get a little outline for chapter 8. God gives to Israel five reasons that the Assyrians are going to come and conquer them. So this is instructive. We should be able to look at this and look at these five reasons. We should be able to see the heart of a loving father communicating to his child why he's bringing correction, why he's bringing chastisement. And that's instructive for us as parents. When you discipline your child, make sure your child knows why you're disciplining them. Church leaders, when we bring discipline into the life of somebody in the church, we make sure that they understand this is why you're being disciplined. Because in the communication of the reasoning of the discipline, you're giving the person the opportunity, yet another opportunity, to be able to repent. So there's five reasons the Assyrians are going to come against the nation of Israel, given to us here in chapter 8. Number one, because they have transgressed my covenant and rebelled against my law. We had a relationship with each other that was based on this agreement, and you have rebelled against it. And God says of Israel, they will cry to me, not crying in sincerity and truth, but they'll cry to me, my God, we know you. You can't do this to us. We know you. And of course, Christians were familiar with this in Matthew chapter 7. Jesus said, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall inherit the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven, he'll be the one that inherits the kingdom of heaven. There will be those that will come to Jesus in that day and say, hey, wait a minute, we prophesied. We were teaching Bible studies for you. Hey, we cast out demons. We interacted in the supernatural realm successfully in your name. Hey, we did wonders in your name. We did miracles. We spoke in tongues. We healed people. We moved in word of wisdom. We moved in word of knowledge. And God will say, depart from me. I never knew you. Israel says, we know you. And in fact, what happens is Israel cries out, hey, God, my God, we know you. And God says of them, Israel has rejected the good, the goodness of God, and the enemy will pursue him. So number one, they've transgressed my covenant. Number two, verse four, they have set up kings. Israel has set up kings, but not by me, the Lord. They made princes, but I did not acknowledge them. The 10 tribes of Israel to the north, the whole nation was founded on rebellion to God. The kings that were ruled over those 10 tribes, they weren't of God's choosing. Number three, the third reason that the Assyrians are going to come and punish the nation, number three, is from their silver and gold, they made or created idols for themselves. So they not only entered into idol worship, but they created their own idols that they might be cut off from fellowship with the Lord, their creator. And so God says of them, your calf, your golden calf is rejected, O Samaria. My anger is aroused against Israel. How long until Israel attains or obtains innocence? For from Israel is even this, a workman made it, the golden calf, and it is not God, but the calf of Samaria shall be broken to pieces. The issue of idolatry is not a small one. I opened up our service with 1 John chapter 3, the first four verses, but also in 1 John 5:21, as John is closing out his letter, he says this, "Little children, keep yourselves from idols." That's New Testament. The exhortation that we as children of God are to keep ourselves from idols. And remember that beautiful definition of idolatry that we got from Isaiah 44:17? Isaiah 44:17, anything that we look on at, anyone we look on at and declare, deliver me, is an idol. I just need deliverance. I just need to check out. It's just a distraction from, I can't handle the world. I can't handle the things that are going on. I just need to be delivered. It's an idol. The only one that we look to for deliverance from anything is the Lord. Oh, if I just had a raise, if I just had a bigger house, if I just had a different spouse, if I just had a different job, then I'd be delivered. We've set up an idol in our hearts. Speaking of Israel, they sow the wind through their worthless worship, their hardness of heart, their blindness of eye, and they reap the whirlwind. Again, it's just the biblical law of sowing and reaping. Whatever you abundantly sow to, you will abundantly reap. So you abundantly sow to looking for deliverance from your idol, you will abundantly reap a relationship with that idol. And the psalmist says that whatever we worship, whatever we look to for deliverance, we become like that thing. The stalk of grain has no bud. It shall never produce meal. If it should produce, aliens or the Assyrians would swallow it up. Israel is swallowed up. Now they are among the Gentiles, like a vessel in which is no pleasure. Notice this, Israel, prophetically here, they're going to be swallowed up among the Gentiles like a vessel in which is no pleasure. The commentator Feinberg, he says this, and I quote, "Nothing so demoralizes us and renders us useless as continued opposition to the revealed will of God for us and our lives." Let me read that again. "Nothing so demoralizes us and renders us useless as continued opposition to the revealed will of God for us and our lives." God calls us to a certain thing. God calls us to a certain life. And we rebel and we kick and we push and we press back against it. Feinberg says, there's nothing more demoralizing and rendering us useless. The fourth reason the Assyrians are going to come and take Israel is, in verse 9, "For they have gone up to Assyria like a wild donkey alone by itself. Ephraim has hired lovers." Israel's looking for love in all the wrong places. Did you want me to sing it? Looking for love? No. Don't do it. They're looking for love. They're looking for deliverance. They're looking for rescue in every place and with everyone but God. You ever known anyone to do that? Christian or not? You're watching their life. You're praying for them. And you see them. You see them calling out for rescue. You see them grabbing for a life ring. And they grab for every life ring other than the Lord. And there's only one life ring. And that is the Lord Jesus Christ. God says, yes, though they, Israel, have hired among the nations seeking deliverance, now I will gather them and they shall sorrow a little. In other words, they'll be chastised for a period of time because of the burden of the king of princes. The fifth reason the Assyrians are coming against them is because Ephraim or Israel has made many altars for sin. They have become for him altars for sinning. In other words, the nation was consumed with sin. So the nation built altars for sin. And as they worshiped their sin on the altars, they sinned evermore. It was cyclical. Sin is cyclical. The more you go for sin, the more you worship sin. The more you go for sin, the more you worship sin. What the beautiful news is and what the wonderful reminder is, righteousness works the exact same way. The more you pursue righteousness, the more you worship the Lord. The more you pursue righteousness, the more you worship the Lord. The more you pursue righteousness, the more you worship the Lord. But Satan doesn't want to remind you of that. Praise God, Hosea does. Ephraim has made many altars for sin. They have become for him altars for sinning. I, the Lord, have written for Israel the great things of my law. I've given them the Pentateuch, the five books of Moses, but they were considered by Israel a strange thing. Israel had God's word, but here's what they said. Oh, that doesn't apply to me. Oh, I don't know anything about that. No, we don't want to get into that. That's old, yeah, Israel. Well, that's Old Testament. We don't want to read that. See, here's what we'll do. When we're living in the cycle of sin, we'll hear God's word and we'll go, wow, man, I hope my wife has taken this down. She really needs it. And God goes, no, I'm talking to you. Oh, no, that doesn't apply to me. For the sacrifices of my offerings, God says, they sacrifice flesh and eat it, but the Lord does not accept them. In other words, they're willing to sacrifice if it benefits them. Hey, I'll go to church because it means a big old feast at mom and dad's house afterwards. No, 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 just don't go to church then and don't have the feast. Now the Lord will remember their iniquity and punish their sins, and they shall return to Egypt. And they did. They put themselves right back into bondage again, this time to the Assyrians. Now, why are these things happening? Why are these five judgments coming against Israel? Look at verse 14 as this concludes the chapter 8. For Israel has forgotten his maker. And notice the M is capitalized. It's speaking of the Lord. Israel has forgotten his maker. You rebel long enough. You posture in pride long enough. You worship those things that bring your flesh deliverance long enough. And you will forget your maker. You will forget. Notice the outcome of their forgetting the Lord. Israel has forgotten his maker and has built temples. And man, do we have the temples built today? The temple to Microsoft, temple to the stock market, the temple to political power, the temple to religious political activism. Judah also has multiplied fortified cities, them trusting in their own strength. But I, the Lord, will send fire upon his cities, and it shall devour his palaces. And that's exactly what happened. The Assyrians totally and completely conquered the 10 tribes to the north, Israel. And they wiped up and mopped up the nation of Judah and all their fortified cities, with the exception of Jerusalem. Chapter 9 gives to us a description from God of what the judgment will look like that comes upon them. Five characteristics of the judgment that will come upon the nation of Israel. I'm not going to kid you. It's ugly. It's meant to be a warning. No pretty little pictures or illustrations here, other than seeing the broken heart of God in his love for his people. Five characteristics of the judgment that will come upon Israel. Number one, the first characteristic is joy will die within the nation. That's given to us in verses 1 and 2. Joy will die in the nation, verses 1 and 2. God says to Israel, do not rejoice, O Israel, with joy like other peoples. In Israel, there was a bountiful harvest. There was prosperity. There was abundance. The stock market was up, wages were up, home ownership was up, giving was up, tax revenue was up, everybody was doing great. God says, don't find joy in that. for you have played the harlot against your God. In other words, you've rejoiced in the benefits that God brought, but you forgot God. And I think you could really just paint the book of Hosea red, white, and blue. Rejoice in God, or rejoice in the benefits that God brings, and forget the giver. God says you've made love for hire, or you've prostituted yourself on every threshing floor. The threshing floor and the wine press shall not feed them, and new wine shall fail in her. In other words, there's going to be famine rather than abundance. One writer has said this: blessings that are abused are taken away by God. Blessings that are abused are taken away by God. How many families have I watched advance through their company, advance in their payroll, their home grows, their bottom line grows, and they refuse to give of their time to the Lord. They refuse to give of their resources to the Lord. They show up, they leave. That's the only interaction they have with God's people. And you watch God come along and just blow it away. Number two, the second characteristic of the judgment of the Assyrians coming upon Israel is found in verses 3-6. Number two, they will be driven out of the land by the Lord through the Assyrians. They'll be driven out of the promised land. Number two, verses 3-6. Israel shall not dwell in the Lord's land, but Ephraim shall return to Egypt or to bondage and slavery, and shall eat unclean things in Assyria. They shall not offer wine offerings to the Lord, nor shall their sacrifices be pleasing to him. It shall be like bread of mourners to them. All who eat it shall be defiled, for their bread shall be for their own life. It shall not come into the house of the Lord. What God is saying here is religious sacrifices of worship to him will cease. And with that, the people won't be pleasing to God. The people will stop worshiping God. And so the pleasure of God will be taken off of them. God says, what will you do in the appointed day, verse 5? And in the day of the feast of the Lord, that is when you're driven out of the land. For indeed they are gone, Israel's out of the land, because of destruction. Egypt shall gather them up, Memphis shall bury them, nettles shall possess their valuables of silver, thorns shall be in their tents. What God says is the nation will and the people will experience complete and total destruction. The third characteristic of the judgment that will come upon them is found in verses 7-9. Spiritual discernment will be lost. Spiritual discernment will be lost. The third characteristic of God's judgment upon the nation of Israel, spiritual discernment will be lost. Listen to how the people handle this. God says, the days of punishment have come. The days of recompense have come. Israel knows the prophet of God, is a fool. The spiritual man, or a man possessing the Holy Spirit, is insane because of the greatness of Israel's iniquity and great enmity. In other words, what's happening here is Israel's sin causes them to see and to label the prophet of God and the man who has the Holy Spirit upon him to be fools, or to be insane, or to be mad. Isn't that the commentary in our country today? A prophet of God, a man with the Holy Spirit upon him, stands up and says, this is sinful because God's word says. And what does the nation declare? You're insane. You're mad. We're going to shut you down. We're going to marginalize you. And I don't speak of just prophet and pastor. How about person who loves God in the job site, in their family? Hey, this is ungodly behavior. We shouldn't be doing this. Well, you're nuts. You're insane. You're mad. And how often does that persecution come from the religious person that you know? You would look and you would think, oh my goodness, that they're religious. They should at least support me. I'm quoting the Bible. And here's the way the religious ungodly behave. Number one, they disobey God. Number two, they disregard God. And finally, thirdly, they end up despising God. Let me give those to you again so you can see them, remember them, and identify them. The religious ungodly, they disobey God. They're not obedient to his word. Then they move to disregarding God. So they start out disobeying him. Then they move to disregarding him. And finally, they end up in the place of despising him. Don't even mention the name of Jesus around me. Don't talk to me any longer about your God. Yeah, but you've gone to church your entire life. God says, verse 8, the watchman or the prophet of Ephraim is with my God, but the false prophet is a fowler's snare in all his ways, enmity or division in the house of his God. There's conflict between the true prophet of God and the false prophet of God within Israel. The false prophet, the nation, they're deeply corrupted as in the days of Gibeah. Now, I'm not going to read that story to you. That's Judges 19, and it is a foul story. One I would not read here in mixed company and with the younger people in our presence. But maybe you should go read it so you can know the reference to it. But the point that I want to bring out is that God refers to the history of Israel to teach them a present-day truth. Guys, we got to know our Bible and we have to remember our history. What are the things that God has taught me in the past and how do they apply to me now? And when we hear God speak in our lives, we need to be prepared to hear God say, hey, remember that time 10 years ago? And he's faithful to remind us. Remember what you did? Remember what I did? Remember how I used that for my glory? Remember what an amazing thing that was? Oh, yeah. God calls Israel to remembrance of their history. Verse 9, the Lord, will remember Israel's iniquity and he will punish Israel's sins. The fourth characteristic of judgment upon the nation of Israel is their birth rate is going to decline. Their birth rate is going to decline. This would be a great place to stop and have a wonderful group discussion on illegal immigration in the United States and why it's such a hot button topic for liberals and conservatives. And the nation of Israel, part of the judgment of God that came upon them as a nation is declining birth rates. Listen to the heart of God and the tenderness of the Father, of our Father, as he speaks with Israel. I found Israel like grapes in the wilderness. I saw your fathers as the first fruits on the fig tree in its season. In other words, God, he presents this picture of coming across Israel, and there they are like beautiful, luscious, bountiful, wild grapes in the midst of a wilderness that's producing nothing. I saw your fathers as the first fruits on the fig tree in its first season. That's the sweetest fruit that the fig tree produces, is the first fruits. So that was my heart. I was like, oh my goodness, look what I found. But what did Israel do? They went to Baal Peor and separated themselves to that shame. Speaking of idol worship, sealed in fornication. They became an abomination like the thing that they loved. I asked you to find Psalm 115 before we started our Bible study. I'm not going to reference it because the clock is telling me I'm out of time or thereabout. But if you would please look at Psalm 115, verses 1 through 8 when you get a chance. Psalm 115, verses 1 through 8. Again, confirming, God says they became an abomination like the thing that they loved. Guys, the thing that we hang our love on, the thing that we hang our affection on, we will become like that thing. And so let's make sure that we love the Lord. As for Ephraim, their glory shall fly away like a bird, no birth, no pregnancy, and no conception. Here's what's going to happen. In the nation of Israel, birth rates are going to fall due to the sin of selfishness. Oh, I'll wait till I'm 50 to start having kids. I want to build a career first. Oh, wait a minute. I can't have kids. Birth rates will fall due to the sin of sacrificing their babies. Well, I don't want this baby. I'll just have an abortion. And birth rates will fall because of slaughter by the enemy. Though they bring up their children, I, the Lord, will bereave them to the last man. In other words, every man in Israel will in some way experience the loss of a child. Yes, woe to them when I depart from them. Just as I saw Ephraim like Tyre planted in a pleasant place, so Ephraim will bring out his children to the murderer. Give them, O Lord, what will you give? Give them a miscarrying womb and dry breasts. Guys, we got to understand verse 14 here, what the cry of Hosea is. He prays and asks God to spare the children of Israel the sin and the wickedness and the destruction that is coming from the Assyrians. In other words, what Hosea prays is, he says, God, it would be better if these people just didn't have children. Because you know children are a gift from God, right? If God doesn't want you to have a child, you're not going to be able to have a child. It's a miracle, no matter what science says. And Hosea prays and he says, you know what? God, just protect these children from ever being conceived, that they would have to experience what is going to happen through the Assyrians. It'd be better if they weren't born. God says in verse 15, all their wickedness is in Gilgal, the location of their idol worship. For there I, God says, I hated them. God is displeased with the rebellion and the idolatry of the nation of Israel, and he says, I hate them. For all of you who have ever considered the saying that God hates the sin but loves the sinner, that is not biblical. God hates sin, and God hates the sinner, and sacrificed his son so that the sinner could be saved, redeemed by his great grace and his great mercy. So you can check that out in Psalm 7 and Psalm 11 as well. All their wickedness is in Gilgal, for there I hated them. Because of the evil of their deeds, I will drive them, God says, from my house. I will love them no more. I'll love them no more as a nation. God continues to love the Jews on an individual basis. Guys, we rejoice that in our day, Jews are getting saved left and right, not only in the nation of Israel, but around the world. We are living in a time where the greatest amount of Jews are giving their life to Jesus, as has ever been the case. As a nation, they continue to live in rebellion to God. They continue to live in a place of chastisement and punishment by God. But on an individual basis, nobody is prevented from giving their life to the Lord Jesus. Isn't that incredible? Guys, you can share the gospel with anybody. Anyone. Do you know that? You can share the gospel with anybody. And whether they receive Jesus or don't, that's a decision that they make. But there's nothing holding us back from those that we share the gospel with. God says all their princes, all their rulers are rebellious. Ephraim is stricken, their root is dried up, they shall bear no fruit. Yes, were they to bear children, I would kill the darlings of their womb. And the fifth and final reason, or the fifth and final characteristic of the judgment that is coming upon the nation of Israel is found in verse 17. My God will cast Israel away. Why will he do that? Because they did not obey him, and they shall be wanderers among the nations. And here's a place of hope, again, that we close on for our Bible study. That's where Israel is to this day, wandering among the nations. However, since 1948, guys, we have the opportunity and the ability to see God by his Holy Spirit regathering the Jews into the nation of Israel in unbelief in the first of two regatherings. They're gathered there now in unbelief, and we will watch during the millennial reign, end of the tribulation, into the millennial reign, as God gathers the Jews back again into the nation of Israel, this time in belief. Belief in the fact that Jesus is their Messiah. Belief in the fact that Jesus is the Lamb slain from the foundations of the world. Watch this. Here's the thought we close with. In the belief and understanding the truth that Jesus is the Good Shepherd who loves them, who cares for them, who watches over them and tends them. And of course, he also is our Good Shepherd. And we want to be reminded of that this morning, that these three chapters of Hosea stand for us as instruction. They stand for us as exhortation. They stand for us as encouragement, just how much God loves his creation. Just how much God loves this world. How much does God love this world? How did we start our Bible study this morning? God so loves this world that he sent his only son, that whoever should believe in him should not perish, but have eternal and everlasting life in him. Father, thank you for your word to us this morning. And Lord, as the invitation goes out to love you, to repent of sin, to receive you as Savior and Lord. As the invitation goes out, maybe to one to remember their Maker, Father, that today would be a day of salvation, that today would be a day of repentance, that, Father, today would be a day of encouragement. Today, a day of salvation for the one who needs to get right with you, to ask you to forgive their sin, and to save them for all eternity. A day of repentance for the one who needs to turn from their sin and once again allow you to rule and reign in their life as Master, as Savior, as lover of their soul. And Lord, a day of encouragement for those that are walking with you, loving you, enjoying you, worshiping you, and waiting with lifted eyes and open arms to be taken up to your great throne of grace forever and for always. Lord, we love you. And Lord, we love to see your love made manifest in your words of encouragement, in your words of discipline, in your actions of chastisement, but also in your glorious actions of cherishing those that you created and that you died for and that you desire to spend all eternity with. Father, pour out your Spirit anew and afresh upon us here this morning, that we would be able to be used for your kingdom in this nation in the last of these days. In your name we pray, amen.